As I was praying and preparing for my Bible sharing with few of our prayer group friends in the UAE, I was prompted to take a topic on Assyria. And I was wondering, why this particular topic? And then I realized it was given to me by the Holy Spirit for a reason, So I would like to share that with you all. Pat? Assyria is basically being spiritually being a spiritual sloth. It is one of the seven capital sins in Christian teaching. Today I would like to touch the topic on Assyria and how it affects us in our spiritual life. Okay, now what is spiritual sloth? Pat the next one. It's a sin of omission. And omission from what basically? It's when we slacken our prayer life. And when we slack towards our duty, in our duties towards one another. But I would like to touch only on the prayers because that's the need of the hour right now. Pat the next. What is slacking in prayers and why does it happen? See, all of us at some point of time has experienced and felt the hand of God upon us, and because of which we have earnestly began to do our own personal prayers, attend prayer meetings, and even started fasting. Now, over a period of time, our spiritual journey with the Lord begins to grow. Now, mind you, there will be times when we are put to the test. And how do we know this? It's basically when we start, when we sit to pray and the words just don't come out, when we totally go blank, when we are zoned out. Or even when we are sitting to pray, and when we are praying, we have other thoughts coming in our mind, like, oh, what do I have to cook today? Or where do I have to go? So these are the temptations that are put to us. Even when we go for mass, we try to avoid sometimes going for mass. That's when we realize that, we are slacking in our prayer life. Now, just because we do not pray does not mean that our spirituality is has gone away. It's just that God is testing us, not for Him to know how strong we are, but for us to realize how weak we are. Now, what does Matthew 26:41 says? It basically tells us to pray for strength against temptation. So our spirit knows what is right for us, and he knows what he has to do. But what we do, we give in to temptation. So our body is very weak. When we start choosing worldly desires and things over our prayers, that's when we automatically, put the Lord last. That's Assyria in our prayer life. Now, why do we become spiritually sloth? Basically, there are three main reasons. One is because we start forming habits. The next is when we start decreasing in vigilance. And the third is when we are being careless. Now, habits are formed when we get too comfortable in our change in routine, especially where our prayer life is concerned, like be it praying at home or even going for Sunday service. I'll take an example of a Sunday service. We as Christians go regularly for Sunday mass, but there will come a time when on a Sunday we are called to work and we give preference to the work than going for mass. It's not that we cannot go for mass. We can go for a Sunday service and then go to work. But we always, we think, okay, fine, we have gone all the other Sundays. So this Sunday, if I leave it's not a big problem. Okay. And couple of Sundays down the line, again, something else comes up, maybe a picnic. And who would want to give up on a picnic? I mean, it's a day of fun and frolic. So again, we put miss mass or miss the Sunday service. And before we know it, we have skipped so many Sunday services that we only start going for services on Easter, Christmas, New Year, or maybe even our birthday. Now, that's when we start drifting away and our spiritual connection with the Lord is lost. Now we start giving worldly desires priority and start putting God in the back burner. Now, any habit can be broken, okay? But it's not difficult to break it. But we have to be true to ourselves and true to God because He is the only one who can help us break this habit. Okay, now what is decreasing in vigilance? This habit is formed basically why? Because our guard is down. Now, since we are in the testing phase, the devil uses all possible ways and means to divert our mind from praying. Now, if we see in Ephesians 6, what does it talk about? It talks about the armor of God. Now, the reason why it talks about the armor of God is so that when we are in battle against Satan, we can be victorious. Okay, he uses all his tricks because he's a pro. So he uses all his tricks for us against us so that we decline in our spiritual life. Now, once and because we don't pray, our guard is down and our armor starts, falling piece by piece. What does Ephesians 6:11 says? It says, put the whole armor of God. It doesn't say put part of the armor. It says put the whole armor of God so that when we are attacked by the devil, we know that we can stand against him and we know that we can be victorious. Now, how does carelessness come into the picture? Now, because we are not alert, we start getting careless and start taking things for granted. We let pride enter into our hearts, which in turn opens the door for the devil. Now, that's really being very careless, because if we are not protecting ourselves, we cannot do anything about it. He will definitely walk in. We have forgotten to lock the door of our hearts, because of which he just walks right in. He makes himself very comfortable and he refuses to go. But mind you, he is not going to be there for a long time. Okay, Satan comes, he comes to steal our grace. What does John 10:10 say? It says that the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. But God's grace, once given to us, will never be taken. But with grace always comes testing. So there will be times when we are tested. Now God allows the devil to enter. He allows him to take control of our life for a certain amount of time. Now God is more powerful. We will not be able to fight the devil, but God can. Why? Because he was the one who made us, as well as he made the devil himself. So God has authority over him and God has the authority to cast him out of us. So you see, because we have formed a habit of not praying, our guard is dropped and we become careless and the end result is acedia. Now, how can we get back into that spiritual state? No matter how strong we are in our spiritual life, we will be put to the test. There's no doubt about it and we cannot avoid it. God shows us that these testing times, how we can become perfect for our eternal life. Like the 10 virgins in Matthew, we have got to be prepared at all times. Now, how can we be prepared? We start wearing the armor of God. We start shining it. We start strengthening it. So that when the time comes for battle, we are ready. Satan is not going to come on our door and knock and he says, okay, I'm going to attack you. No, he just comes. He comes and he strikes us. Okay? God's hand is never removed from us. It's always there. But he allows us to be tested, just like he tested Job. Trust me, with our own hard work, we are not able to do it. We will never be able to fight Satan. So we have to have God in our life. We have to call out to him for assistance. We've got to call out to him to help us to get through this phase of, this testing period. Now, yes, when we take the Lord's name, he will definitely come to our aid. And the devil flees on his name. But that doesn't mean that every time we call out, Lord, Lord, come help me, he's going to come to help us. I mean, if he's going to come every time to help us, the time we call, because you're going to start taking him for granted. And how are we ever going to learn? How are we ever going to fight our battles? Yes, God is going to be there with us to fight our battles, but he still needs us as a Christian, as a child of God to fight it, and he will be there to support us. Now, he's basically teaching us how to ride a bicycle. He lets us fall, and he'll pick us up. Again, he lets us fall. He makes us do that a couple of times before we can perfect our ride. And when I say perfect our ride, it's basically when we start surrendering to the Lord and we call out to the Holy Spirit to help us. Now, what does Romans 8 tells us? Paul says that the same Spirit that was in Jesus rose from the dead is living in us. And he goes further to say in verse 26, even though we do not know how to pray, that's, when we come into that spiritual slot of not praying, of getting zoned. zoned out, that's when the spirit will reach out to the heavens. He will cry out to God for us, and he will call out to Abba Father. I ask you all to please call out to the Holy Spirit when you all are in, when you all are faced with this kind of a temptation, when you all are faced in this kind of a situation, call out to him. He will definitely come to our aid. Why? Because God has promised us, Jesus has promised us, saying that whenever we call out to him, no matter what situation, he says if you call out his name, he will come to us and he will set us free. Amen. Lord Jesus, we come to you today and thank you for the privilege of praying for others. We ourselves have been the recipient of others' prayers, O Lord God, and we understand how powerful prayer is. I ask you first to cleanse us, O Lord God, cleanse our hearts, bring to mind the unconfessed sins that are in our own lives and in our own hearts, Lord, so that when we pray for others, our prayers will not be hindered. I thank you that through your name, we can come boldly before you and pray with confidence according to your will and know that you hear our prayers, Lord. Lord Jesus, I surrender at your feet our mind, our body, our soul and our spirit, Lord. Heavenly Father, I ask you to cover each and every one present here. Cover all our family members who cannot be here with us right now, Lord. Cover them with your precious blood, O Lord God. Strengthen our family and those closest to us, O Lord God. May your love for us and the love that we have for you help us to love others and forgive others. Lord Jesus, I pray for the brokenhearted, for the sick, for the bereaved. I pray for the elderly people, Lord, elderly parents who have been forgotten, who have been abandoned by their family, Lord. Protect the defenseless, Lord, and hold them close to your heart. I make this prayer in your loving name, O Lord. Amen.